a genius in his native Trinidad and Tobago, and listed among the world's first 25 exponents of the sitar in his category. Mangal Pateser is the timeline between his ancestral past and the genetic strings to which was unknowingly attached the making of a musical wonder of the 21st century. Like the great musicians of the world, Mangal Pateser, grandson to indentured immigrants, has carved a place for his music, his nation, and himself in that prestigious sanctuary reserved for gurus whose contributions to human development are archived for generations unborn. For us in the Caribbean, and in particular Trinidad and Tobago, the birth of this divine honor is rooted in fate-ridden voyages, on which came uncharted pioneers whose offsprings would keep alive centuries-old unexplored talents to form an overwhelming component of the legacy of our ancestors. Going overseas in search of menial jobs meant that the Indians were defying ancient custom and tradition. They knew that crossing the Kalapani was taboo and that caste complexities made re-entry into the land of their birth difficult, if not impossible. Yet they were prepared to undertake the risk, not because of the wages, but because of the threats of starvation. Additionally, they would endure intolerable conditions of a horrifying three-month journey from India to Trinidad, during which they would be treated no less than obscure human cargo. Notwithstanding, when the 226 pioneering Indians arrived in distant Trinidad and Tobago on May 30, 1845, they would begin a mission that would change forever the economic and cultural landscape of this archipelagic island in the British West Indies. Over a period of 72 years, 320 voyages would transport approximately 148,000 immigrants who planted seeds that would germinate into a fertile and plenteous sugarcane land, producing citizens who labored selflessly to raise families, build communities, and bring prosperity to this nation. It would also deliver to the world, during the passage of time, sons and daughters of international stature. These architects of the future had come from Bhojpuri-speaking areas as well as other parts of Bharat with distinct characteristics and cultural values. 84% of the initial shipload were Hindus, with 15% Muslims, and 1% consisting Christians, Buddhists, and tribal people. This transplantation was aptly described as another form of the long-standing horror of human slavery engineered by European exploiters, as British-sponsored recruiters or arkatyas virtually tricked vulnerable and poverty-stricken immigrants into accepting five-year contracts to fill the void created by African slaves who gradually fled the sugarcane and cocoa plantations before the abolition of slavery in 1838.
The Africans demanded a 100% increase in the wage which was then being offered, which was 24 cents, 1 shilling. And they said, quite justifiably, that this isn't enough for us to make a living because we are no longer slaves and we want to have a good, decent wage. And so the planters also refused this request. Whereupon the Africans left and went and set up their own villages throughout the Caribbean, in Trinidad, in Guyana, in Barbados, in Jamaica, in most of the islands. And the result of that abandonment of the estates was that the sugar industry was faced with ruin. There are many reports that went to Parliament. There are many articles in the newspapers in the Caribbean at that time in which the planters were bemoaning the fact that they would now be impoverished if they didn't find some substitute kind of labor to replace the depleted African labor force.
Those who remained on the estates were engaged mainly in semi-industrial chores, such as mechanics, boilermen, carpenters, and blacksmiths. Desperate to find new help, the planters experimented unsuccessfully with labor from various parts of the world, including nearby West Indian islands, France, Germany, Madeira, and the USA.
They picked up hucksters and carters and peddlers and boatmen in the area around Hong Kong and Macau. So when these Chinese came, they were not agricultural Chinese, so they went off initially into shopkeeping. And quite often, once they set themselves up in shopkeeping, they paid off their own indentureship and bought out the indentureships of other Chinese who were on the estates. So that this obviously was not satisfactory. The planters didn't bring the Chinese to open shops. They brought them to work on the estates, and this wasn't working at all. And then the planters went to the poor of Europe, the poor French and Irish persons and people from Madeira in the Azores. But these people were also unsuccessful because they found it difficult to acclimatize themselves to the very hot tropical conditions, and then they were not accustomed to the growing of sugarcane. They were accustomed to the cultivation of vines, and therefore a number of them died, a number of them suffered from all kinds of serious skin diseases because of the heat of the climate and the hotness of the sun, and therefore that didn't work also. And then they went to North America and sought to bring Africans from North America who wanted to start a new life somewhere else. And so a number of Africans were brought, African Americans, and this also didn't work out well because as bad as conditions were in North America, they were much worse in the Caribbean.
Apart from their unsuitability, argues Professor Bridget Brereton, the labor problems could have been satisfied if the planters were prepared to offer a higher wage to the emancipated slaves.
Lots of West Indians emigrated to Trinidad and Guyana, not as indentured laborers, as free laborers. If the planters had been willing to pay them better wages, if even the planters had been prepared to think about a free, unindentured migration from India and China and perhaps Madeira, etc., those could have worked. So I have to answer you, no. I don't think indenture was absolutely necessary. I think you can argue that the immigration of workers was probably necessary if the sugar industry was to survive in Trinidad. But you could have brought in workers under different kinds of systems than the indenture system.
Certainly not amenable to such financial investments, the planters continued their search in India, over which Britain held dominion from the middle of the 18th century. The labor scouts used various methods to secure candidates for indentureship. A few came from Madras in the south, but the majority lived in populated towns and villages of northeastern Indian states, such as Bihar and Uttar Pradesh.
Patna, Faizabad, Murshidabad, Lucknow, Banaras, all of these areas were major recruiting centers, because they were highly industrialized areas, areas in which there were millions of people, areas in which you had very frequent religious activities. And very often at these bazaars and at these melas and at a Diwali celebration, the recruiters, the arkatiyas they were called, would go around and try to scope out the situation.
Complacency and willingness to seek jobs elsewhere existed due to a number of factors, and long before Caribbean indentureship. On the one hand, the British capitalist class felt that India could satisfy the labor needs of other British interests, and on the other, because of severe economic hardships created by British imperial policies that rendered many peasants landless and subservient.
many peasants who owned land became landless, or they became just labor, agricultural labor. In other words, their whole economy shattered, whatever it was, and they just became paupers.
A few years before they arrived in the West Indies, Indian immigrants had sailed to Mauritius in search of employment. Therefore, volunteering for another crossing was simply searching for new forms of survival and a better life, hopefully one superior to impoverishment and despair. They were also evading the rigors of devastating droughts, of severe flooding and hunger caused sometimes by man-made famine. The human cargo consisted Indian freedom fighters that were escaping the vengeance of British authorities, who rained terror on those involved in the Indian Revolt of 1857, the first major rebellion against British rule in India.
Now, once the revolt was suppressed, British followed twofold policy in the rural areas of Bhojpuri region, which is called Eastern Uttar Pradesh, or in Bihar. Now, one important aspect of the policy was not to recruit the Indians or the peasants of that region in army, and second was giving them exemplary punishment, hanging them on the trees. Now, this kind of policy explained two points. One is that those who revolted have been punished, and it was also a lesson for those who did not participate, which means that British would not only rule peacefully, but if needed, they could apply force. Under the conditions, those who found that they would not be able to live comfortably here decided for an alternative.
Among the immigrants were persons who made the trip simply out of a sense of adventure. A few ran away from brushes with the law and bitter family disputes. Many pregnant wives used indentureship as a form of rescue from unworthy husbands whom they were forced to marry because their parents benefited from the dowry system. And then there were the sad stories of kidnapping.
There are a number of instances of a young girl, for example, going to fetch water, and these thugs, these thieves, these gundas would be around, and they'd capture her and take her away screaming to the coolie depot, where she would be threatened that if you made any trouble, if you made any difficulty, you would be killed. And so she had to agree to their conditions and then was brought to Calcutta. There are all of these kinds of tricks and devices that we use to inveigle people out of the life that they had and force them into indentureship.
Like Partabia Golia, who at aged 20 was snatched from her in-laws' home and kept isolated at the coolie depot before boarding her ship to Trinidad. She recalled having seen several of her villagers in a similar predicament, weeping helplessly as the ship left port. Unable to withstand the emotional separation, many of them committed suicide by throwing themselves overboard. But perhaps the most attractive inducement to come to Trinidad were the promises of grandeur and wealth peddled by deceitful Arkatyas, whose primary objective was to secure huge financial rewards for bringing to the coolie depot at Garden Reach in Calcutta large contingents of immigrants, irrespective of age, caste, gender, religion, or willingness. Long before they arrived in Trinidad, those stories of milk and honey dished out by the Arkatyas would spill and drown in the oceans. Firstly, the immigrants would be detained at the points of departure for very long periods. Life in the coolie depots was harsh and shocking, particularly to the Hindus, who were grouped together regardless of their caste differences. Conditions were filthy, with the constant prospect of an outbreak of contagious diseases. On board the ships, it was no different. And along the way, the immigrants would die a thousand deaths over the Pagal Samundar or Crazy Seas.
The most difficult part of that very difficult crossing from India to the Americas was in a region which the Indians called the Pagal Samundar. That is the Mad Sea. That's the translation of the word. And the Pagal Samundar is the area just south of the Cape of Good Hope, where there is a meeting between the cold waters of the Antarctic and the warm waters of the Atlantic on the one side, or the Indian Ocean. So it's a meeting of cold and hot. It's a meeting of very powerful currents that are coming from the south up north, and very powerful counter currents that are going from the north down south. So it's a very turbulent, an extremely turbulent area. And sometimes a ship would take a week, sometimes 8 to 9 days, just to make the crossing south of the Cape of Good Hope. And during that time, most of the Indians would have to be down beneath. Most of them would be mourning and crying and you know, feeling that this is the end of the world. And quite often the ship was badly damaged and had to put in at the Cape of Good Hope for repairs and so on. But the Cape of Good Hope was not normally a stopping point, except for times of such disturbance.
Along the journey, fatal diseases aboard the ships would deprive mothers and fathers of their offsprings, and young children would lose parents. Disposal of the dead would be painfully unceremonious.
Quite often there were epidemics of cholera and dysentery and all kinds of diseases. And these ill persons were isolated, and once they died, they were put in a bag, and holy stone, it is called, that is an enormous brick, was tied to the bag, and they were just thrown into the sea.
With bitter memories of a most horrifying journey still fresh in their minds, they would reach port of Spain after 90 days, fatigued and almost lifeless, but thankful that they'd arrived alive. The Jahajis would disembark the Fath al-Razak and immediately perform Dandawat, a sacred act of touching Dharti Mata or Mother Earth after the long and life-threatening crossing. The sick and feeble would be taken to the colonial hospital in Port of Spain, whilst the others would walk to the coolie depot not far from where the ships would berth.
Those who were well enough would be taken by these horse carriages to their estates in various parts of Trinidad, a large number of them to what was called Coolie Town, which is now St. James, a large number of them to what is now, well, to the Diego Martin estates, which is now in the Diamond Vale area, a number of them to estates all along what is now the East-West Corridor, to Tacarigua, and to Dinsley, and to Malabar Estate in Arima, and to San Juan Estate and El Socorro Estate, all of these estates on the East West Corridor, as well as to many estates down in the south. So they'd be taken there and, of course, allocated according to the number that the planter had been previously given.
Before leaving the coolie depot, someone would plant peepal trees as a mark of investiture to indicate an early presence in Port of Spain, as they prepared to anchor on the estates and plantations to begin a new life. Those who made the trip would also discover in themselves a stamina they perhaps never knew existed. On the estates, they'd be placed like their African brothers and sisters in cramped barrack houses, bare of furnishings, with no privacy nor amenities. They lived in an inhospitable environment. They fetched drinking water from infested drains and canals. Diseases were rampant, and medical care was woefully inadequate. As a consequence, deaths occurred on a regular basis. The empty bowels of compassion were most evident.
In fact, most of the Indians, for long periods of Indianship, had to go and relieve themselves in the fields, in the drains, in the areas outside of these barracks, which is one of the reasons for a very high incidence of hookworm. Because the Indians were not provided with boots, for example, they had to move barefooted most of the time, and then they had to walk in these areas which were open toilets, you can say. And therefore the incidence of hookworm was very high indeed. It was one of the continuous problems, and there were constant admonitions to the estate owners that you should build latrines so that the Indians would use that facility. But not every estate owner wanted to expend further money in building further facilities.
In addition to the health hazards, the immigrants would unfortunately face open hostility from the freed slaves, who accused them of being strike breakers or scab labor, because they accepted a 24 cents daily wage, which the Africans had justifiably refused after they were freed. In agreeing to work for 24 cents a day before leaving Calcutta, the immigrants were unaware of any negotiations between the planters and the freed slaves.
They were simply told when they left India and when they came to the Caribbean that your wage is 24 cents a day. And they were ignorant, they were oblivious of the earlier disputes that had taken place between the Africans and the plantation owners. So in their point of view, 24 cents was in fact the average wage. This is what they were being offered. This is what they had contracted themselves to receive for 5 years. And therefore they accepted it, not knowing the earlier difficulty. But the African, not knowing that the Indian was ignorant of the labor dispute, he blamed the Indian for coming and accepting what he called a slave wage. And this was always a source of contention between African and Indian, because the African argued that had the Indian not come, then it's quite possible the planter would have been forced to raise the wage to an acceptable level. But he saw the Indian as a strike breaker, as a person who was displacing him on the plantations.
Notwithstanding these conditions, fixed in their minds would be the task of fulfilling their contractual obligations, and in the process further enrich the planters, which they would achieve with passionate ease because of their obeisance to Dharti Mata, their dedication to duty, and devotion to and knowledge of their agrarian way of life. For the first half of the year, life on the estates meant work from dawn to dusk. The Jahajis would head to the sugarcane fields long before sunrise to harvest the crops while the planters and the rest of the nation were still enjoying their sleep.
It was dawn to dusk during crop season, as it had been for the African. So once the crop season had started, then it would be, you know, would have to get up at 5 in the morning, start work at 6, and you go to 4 or 5 in the afternoon. So one can say for about 3 months of the crop season, it was really very difficult, it was very arduous, it was really dawn to dusk.
The women of the estates had multiple responsibilities. In addition to preparing the meals and managing the household, they looked after the children even whilst assisting their husbands in the fields.
When a woman arrived as an adult, she was indentured. So we have to be clear in our minds that women were indentured also. So that an adult woman arriving, and quite a few of them arrived with small children because they had been married in India, she was obliged to work. Her tasks were slightly different from the tasks typically given to men, but the fact is she was expected to turn out every morning, Monday to Friday, and do field labor or other jobs. If she had small children, generally I think on the estates, an older woman looked after the very small children. Children from the age of 6 or 7 were drafted into the labor force. They were not indentured, but they were expected to give labor. They were just paid a few cents for cutting grass and that kind of job, looking after animals. So yes, indeed, she had to juggle, as working women always have had to, multiple responsibilities. She certainly had to do housework and cooking in her barrack room, or perhaps the cottage, wherever she lived. She would have to do childcare. And as long as she was indentured, she would be expected to turn out each day to do her task. It's true that on the better managed estates, pregnant women or women nursing babies would not be expected to do a full task every day. But the contract required women as well as men to perform labor.
When she returned, the home chores would begin all over again.
Life as an indentured Indian woman on the plantations was a very hard life. They had to do hard physical labor. Their living conditions were wretched, and they were vulnerable to sexual abuse by plantation staff. And, let us be honest, by Indian men. Because in addition to the overseers, who were generally white, you had the sirdars or drivers, and these were Indian men given positions of authority. And there's pretty good evidence that some of those men also abused the younger women.
During crop over, the immigrants would engage in equipment repair and general off-season maintenance in readiness for the next harvest. For 13 cents per day, some women would plant and salt the canes, while others would weed and dig paragrass in the noonday sun. These simpler post-crop chores would allow them a little more time to practice the agrarian skills they brought, adding to what the Africans had already started centuries before.
They added their own crops, such as swamp rice. That is something that they brought, things like guava, new strains of bananas, pomegranates, mango, and then the water buffalo, which they call the bhains, the zebu bull, the zebu cow, new varieties of goats, all kinds of vegetables, a whole wide range of different kinds of pulses, different kinds of bhaji, peppers, all kinds of new crops and new animals, which changed the whole physical landscape with the cultivation or the rearing of these animals.
But even among the immigrants, life on the sugarcane plantations was not as sweet as many had hoped it would be. There were many anxious moments between the immigrants, between overseer and laborer, and driver and worker. The central source of the discontent originated from a type of control instigated by the planters and perpetrated by the gang leaders. The movement of immigrants was regulated by a system of ordinances that kept them isolated on the plantations. They journeyed from one place to another only through official passes when it was absolutely necessary and at the sole discretion of the overseers. Failure to obey the rules, the immigrants felt the full force of cruel taskmasters, which included swift and brutal punishment that often resulted in pernicious flogging and invariably unnecessary and humiliating incarceration. In this case, punishment was not reserved only for the male, but for the weak and defenseless women of the estates. This type of subjugation often evoked fierce but ineffectual reactions from the men, who felt that they alone had the right to punish their wives and soulmates.
The driver come and hit my mother. When them hit my mother, my father say, "We no have no right to hit my wife. Because India rule is that." He say, them tell my father, the man and them tell my father. He say, "Look how he hit Bhauji." He say, "Nah, we want to go India again." He from Pitimon, them start to come San Fernando. From San Fernando, them watching the sea, very high road to pass, very high road.
Purnima's father's objection is informed by the thesis that flogging and incarceration for minor law-breaking and misdemeanors was not written in his contract. As a consequence, many of the Jahajis believed that they were deceived.
This was never told in the contract. I've seen the contract, the original contract, that is never mentioned. And while that was the central feature of the indenture system, that if you didn't work or if you had some misdemeanor, it's a huge variety, about 140 clauses were there, from hospital rules to barrack, how do you keep your barrack house, to how do you work. There were 140 types of breaches. Yeah, and then you could be in jail. And as you know that amongst the labor, roughly the average rate of incarceration, that means being prosecuted for, was something like 25-30%. So every person in his period of, most probably on an average, every person might be in jail for at least 14 days.
Additionally, overseers would command some women to report to their bungalows for disguised house chores, where they would be abused and violated. In many instances, the overseers would manufacture reasons to imprison some husbands in order to commit their acts of brutality against these innocent women.
The overseers were nearly all young men, unmarried men. Most of them were white. I guess a few were local, mixed-race men. And they were in the middle of a population of resident laborers, some indentured, some not. But these were all people who were very much in the power of the estate management. And obviously that was a situation reminiscent of slavery, where the young women were vulnerable to sexual predators among the management staff. So there's no question that this did happen. Now, it was, of course, frowned on by the local government, by the Protector of Immigrants Office, and by the more intelligent managers, because they recognized that perhaps no other issue caused so much discontent and so much rebellion among the estate indentured labor force than interference, as it was politely called, with the Indian women.
The system of recruitment paid lip service to sociological factors, in particular the imbalance of men to women ratio, despite the fact that the authorities had mandated that women constitute one third of every shipload of immigrants coming to the West Indies. The planters were desperate for muscle labor on the plantations. The Arkatiyas, on the other hand, were only interested in satisfying their depraved lust for wealth. However that was achieved was their major concern.
Obviously, what happens is that if you have a system of labor, you're trying to attract labor. What was required at first was able-bodied labor to work on plantations, and able-bodied labor was generally seen as male labor. So the system started with obviously more men. However, within the plantations and on the estates where many men were housed, there began to be problems of just, I would call it unhappiness of various sorts. You have to remember as well that you are drawing men from India who are young, who within India, they would have had their lives arranged. They would have had arranged marriages. They would have had the usual rug of customs around them. And you are now displacing them. And you bring them into a setting in which they are now ill at ease.
Indentureship also created new ways in which Indian women and men viewed each other away from the protective surveillance of their parents.
You began to have a group of women who are now again displaced from India, in where they also would have had their lives arranged and where they would have been not in short supply. They are shifted to Trinidad and to the rest of the Caribbean, and they are now in greater demand. So you begin to change the entire system of sexuality, if you like, of the way in which Indian men and women would have related to each other if they were in India, under the eyes of their family.
The indentured female, already in short supply on the plantations, could now bargain with the currency of her sexuality, and this resulted in bitter social problems like domestic violence, wife murders, and suicides.
I think once you disrupt any set of migrants, you begin to create problems. And what became more popular, what we know more, is the whole notion of wife murders, and men would then maybe maim or kill their wives. But what was not mentioned as much was the amount of men who also committed suicide on doing that. So I think one has to be very careful in looking at the area to see that both men and women suffered. However, it has left a kind of legacy for us of the notion of very violent coolie behavior.
I think a lot of women were routinely beaten, and occasionally these kinds of episodes climaxed in murders of women by their husbands. Usually, of course, the woman was dead, so she couldn't bear testimony, but in the trials that resulted, the argument always was that she had been unfaithful to him, she had left him, and his honor required that he should kill her. And quite a few men were, in fact, convicted and hanged for murdering their wives under these circumstances. And historians are quite sure that this comes out of the special situation, the very distorted living conditions on the plantations. It happened in Guyana, in Mauritius, in Fiji. It was a common pattern where you had the people living together with a skewed sex ratio and under very peculiar living conditions.
Unable to withstand the pains of separation coupled with the rigors of plantation life, many an immigrant male ended up destitute or on the wayside, with the colonial authorities taking no responsibility for these helpless souls. Despite these harrowing experiences, the immigrants survived and prospered through various means, particularly through their religion, during which they recreated village India as perhaps the most strategic form of survival. A strange land, and peoples whose cultural inheritances were different to theirs, but who experienced an historical sameness. The daunting circumstances of a journey they'd never forget, and the trials of a difficult plantation life. The immigrants summoned their survival instincts. On the estates, they maintained a self-inflicted separation from within their own groups and from mainstream Trinidadian society. This perhaps was a hangover from the extremely strong caste system that existed in colonial India. Invariably, tempers would flare and sharp quarrels would develop among the Jahajis. But open hostility towards them from the freed African slaves, coupled with the nakedness of a brusque plantation environment, they were compelled to dismantle whatever social or religious barriers existed among them. Walls broken down and the quest for survival prominent on their agenda, these Jahaji Bhais and Bahins weaned into their small communities a compelling sense of togetherness and cooperation. Cultural practices deemed pagan by the British and considered strange to others who preceded the immigrants made it difficult, almost lawless, to practice their religions and invoke their cultural prowess. They sang their ganas and played their dhuns or music within the confines of their cramped accommodation. In the stillness of night, music from the sitar, sarangi, dholak, dhantal, and basuri would fill the air as they petitioned their only links with a distant homeland.
Already we've seen parts of that historical journey and the circumstances that led to the arrival of indentured immigrants from India to Trinidad and Tobago. Well, as you know, one of the conditions under which they came was to work for 5 years under a system of paid contract labor, albeit for 24 cents per day, after which they would be given a return passage back home. But that did not go as planned.
The general pattern was that the more the colonial powers understood that the Indians were here to stay, most of them, the less were the incentives to stay. So initially, if you re-indented yourself for an additional period of 5 years, and therefore you saved the British Treasury the expense of having to repatriate you to India, you were given £5 and 5 acres of land. Later on, you could be given £5 and 10 acres of land. After a time, the money incentive was totally removed and you could get 5 acres of land. After a time, the Indian had to contribute to his or her own return to India. So the conditions varied.
Nelson Island is an old fortress replete with various stages of Trinidad's history. The British captured it from the Spaniards in 1797. African slaves constructed its first major building in 1802, and between 1865 to 1917, it was used as a quarantine for the immigrants, because the colonial hospital in Port of Spain was complaining that the disease-bearing coolies were occupying crucial bed space at the institution.
Across from Nelson is Lenegan Island, which housed a hospital built especially to accommodate disease-bearing immigrants, many of whom died and were cremated here, not out of a sense of respect, but because it was impossible to dispose of the dead in the stony grounds. Ironically, cremation of the Indian dead was not permitted in mainland Trinidad until 1946. However, it was here on Nelson Island that the new arrivals bonded and exchanged stories and shared cultural differences. That bond transcended the divisions of caste and religion. On evenings, as the sun began to set, they'd sit under the trees and sing their songs, hoping that the calm waters of the ocean would transmit to their loved ones at home the pains of their loneliness and despair. The small percentages of those eager to return to families in India were quarantined on Nelson Island before repatriation. Invariably, existing conditions in India and the difficulty associated with re-entering Indian society because of the caste system forced many of them to return to Trinidad.
Some of them even came to know that they belonged to the upper caste in the ships, on the ships, or when they landed here. To me, it seems that some of the people who even belong to the upper caste found their conditions helpless in India for one reason or the other. It may be economic, it may be social, and here was an alternative. But we have to keep one thing more in mind. They were going as an indentured labor. They thought that they might return after 5 years. Now, there was a fear of social, you may say, boycott once they return. But more important was survival. Once they could survive for 5 years, once they could live outside their own society, that was also an important issue at that time.
Between 1869 to 1880, many ex-indentured immigrants benefited from a short-lived land commutation scheme.
During that short period, quite a lot of ex-indentured immigrants got grants of 5 or perhaps in a few cases 10 acres of crown lands in lieu of commutation. That meant they had to sign a little piece of paper saying they gave up their rights of repatriation. So a relatively small number of ex-indentured Indians were granted free grants of crown land. The acreage was, I believe, about 19,000 acres. Much of the land was pretty bad land. It was marginal or difficult to cultivate. the great majority of ex-indentured Indians who acquired land did so not through free grants, but through purchase. In 1869, at exactly the same time the commutation scheme began, the government in Trinidad opened up the crown lands for sale in relatively small portions. Previously, you'd had to buy huge blocks, which meant nobody except wealthy capitalists could. But from 1869, it was possible to purchase 5 or 10 acres of crown land at reasonable prices. And as a result, many thousands of ex-indentured Indians and many thousands of Trinidadians of other ethnic groups purchased crown land. So it was mainly through the purchase and leasing of land that Indians acquired real estate property.
Some settled within close proximity of the sugarcane fields and factories and continued to work on the estates. Others became their own zamindars or landowners and began hiring freed immigrants to work for them, growing food crops and vegetables, cultivating sugarcane, reaping cocoa and coffee, and rearing animals. With the passage of time, they'd purchase more land. These concepts of thrift and sacrifice resulted from adversity and hardships of plantation life. They pinched at their earnings to purchase only what they did not produce from the land. Oftentimes, they were regarded as penurious or stingy, but were in fact saving for the proverbial rainy day. By 1884, some of them had accumulated appreciable savings from their meager estate earnings. Gradually, they began acquiring wealth and applied to their inheritances the raw skills of peasantry and dharmic devotion to the land. They reclaimed swamps, cleared forests, and constructed houses of mud walls and thatch roofs that seemed simple, yet with sound economic principles that reflected their culture of frugality.
Rosilac area was made up of Indians who had migrated from other parts of Trinidad to Rosilac in the Oropouch Lagoon, where such land was being made available.
The wealthier among the immigrants demonstrated a greater ambition and acquired, instead of thatch roofs, galvanized coverings to secure their houses. For the first time since arrival in 1845, they really enjoyed privacy and space to raise families. Slowly, they began to express more openly, albeit with considerable official resistance, their rich cultural traditions, whether in dance, the music of their forefathers that kept burning in their hearts, or the songs that would subliminally transport them back to Mother India in times of despair and desperation. As the system of indentureship continued, new shiploads of Girmitias or agreement signers would arrive from different parts of the Indian subcontinent, bringing their own customs and traditions and adding to the opulent repository of time-honored rituals, festivals, and ceremonies. What are some of these customs and traditions, and how have they survived in cosmopolitan Trinidad and Tobago? How have the immigrants fared in an environment unkind and unfriendly, and sometimes even hostile? The pioneering Indian stepped off the ship and onto this land of a brighter tomorrow with anticipation. They brought almost no material possession, except a jahaji bundle of clothing, some musical instruments, thousands of stories or kisas in their heads, multiple skills, a few holy books, and an abiding faith in their religious beliefs. They knew, whatever the circumstances, they possessed the knowledge and capacity to persevere, and they did, invariably invoking that strong inner spirit to reincarnate village India and to use the experience of plantation life as a lesson in human survival and enterprise.
The story of Ram was a story of exile, and the story of the jahajis, or forefathers who came on an intended ship,
was a story of exile also. And because they hardly had any text with them in the early time, they remembered the traditions of Ram. And that is what was a term of reference for them to adapt into this landscape and to be able to use as a guide, a moral and principal guide for their own life. So you see, the Ramayana text really, and the inspiration of the Ramayana is what set their whole life.
The immigrants came with an education and a sense of worship that took many forms, whether it was to Dharti Mata or the earth, the river or Ganga Maya, the stone or the flower. Therefore, the absence of the physical structure was never an impediment in the observance of their religious practices. They sang their Ramayana and performed their pujas under shady peepal or mango trees. Invariably, on evenings they would gather under these sacred grounds to sing their lullabies and entertain themselves, trying to heal the wounds of defeat on the estates. The majority of Muslim immigrants in an undivided India brought many of their religious beliefs and doctrines, but few public observances.
The Muslim religion has the basic festival which you have is Eid al-Adha and Eid al-Fitr. Then you have the Ramadan, which is a slow month of sacrifice. You can't eat things that are normally lawful during that period. So the strictness of the religion is the answer, the reason why you do not see Islam being projected in a sort of a fetish mode or in a celebratory mode like that. They don't do that.
Eid al-Fitr, which marks the end of the Ramadan fasting, is perhaps the most universal celebration in the Islamic calendar, and one on which Muslims universally are on common ground. Eid al-Adha, or celebration of the Prophet's birthday, is another. However, according to retired Justice Ralph Narayan, what they knew and practiced in their villages formed the sum total of what came with the Islamic jihadis.
They brought, of course, such of the Islamic training, which I'm sure was rather unorthodox, but which arose out of practice among them in their own villages. So that they knew of mosques, they knew of Quranic readings, they knew of singing qasidas. But outside of that, I don't think they brought anything Sikh, for example, in music, because at one time it was thought that music was anathema to Islam. Painting, I don't recall anything coming in that form of art from the Muslim community. Hosse, that came down because that had its origin in the martyrdom of the grandsons of the Prophet Hassan and Hussein.
This point of view is supported by Dr. Prabhu Mohapatra, who says that Hosse was a major commemoration in Lucknow, a city from where thousands of immigrants came to the Caribbean.
It was there in almost all North Indian cities in the 19th century, it would be practiced. But the biggest and the best was in Lucknow, which was a Shiite kingdom, the Awadh kingdom. And that's where a lot of people came from also to Trinidad, also to other countries. What is interesting is that Muharram, the celebration or the kind of Muharram became the festival, the only perhaps the most important festival for Indians wherever they went in the plantations, wherever. That means to Mauritius, to Malaysia, to Suriname, to Fiji, to everywhere, to West Indies. It was there. It was there throughout the 19th century, the single most important festival. And there, both Hindus and Muslims, all sects, would participate.
But whilst Hosse has its origins in the sands of Karbala in Iraq, and in fact came with the immigrants from India, it is considered un-Islamic by conventional Muslims.
The ordinary Muslims who don't believe in Hosse they read the Quran and they make prayers and so on for the soul of Imam Hussein, because Imam Hussein was slaughtered by the enemies of the Prophet who never believed in God and who were believing in propagating themselves. So that tradition came down here from the east into Trinidad, where a number of people gathered and built these structures, which they call Hussein. Very beautiful, but it is to the Orthodox Muslims un-Islamic.
The majority of Muslims in Trinidad and Tobago are Sunnis, and Hussein is observed primarily by Shiite Muslims. It is considered by some to be one of the more visually attractive events that has some traditional Hindu characteristics. Hence the reason Hindus and other non-Muslim groups participate in the event each year.
The early Muslims did not know of these divisions. Those who are Sunnis are those who are supposed to follow the Sunnah of the Prophet. So when I say follow the Sunnah of the Prophet, in addition to the Holy Quran.
However, for the immigrants, Hussein, with all its solemnity, represented more an Indian rather than an Islamic commemoration, and gave them an opportunity to demonstrate, mainly through the procession, an integral component of their history.
It is a point of display, of showing that we are a community. We live here not merely as labor, but we also have a life and world outside. It was also a way in which they wanted to get out of the immobilized condition on the plantation, and that's why it was so popular. It allowed them express themselves and imprint themselves on the public space.
Notwithstanding this issue, the Islamic presence in Trinidad and Tobago is noticeably strong, and Muslims play an important role in the cohesiveness of this plural society through religion, education, and commerce.
The course of history has provided for all of us a place in this cosmopolitan island paradise of Trinidad and Tobago. Therefore, the way we choose to live or interact with each other would determine to what extent we really understand and respect the pains, sufferings, and sacrifices of our ancestors who made the crossings, whether they came first, second, or third. It would also demonstrate what we've learned from these lessons of history in order to shape our own future and to ensure that we do not repeat the evils of European imperialism. Whilst the planters quite naturally sought to reclaim their pound of flesh labor, invariably through cruel, hostile, and repugnant ways, the Indians invoked their cultural resilience and adaptation as perhaps the most persistent form of resistance against the barbarity of plantation life. A quality, and indeed a culture, they passed on to succeeding generations, unquestionably a legacy worthy of emulation. I'm Gideon Hanuman Singh. Thank you for viewing.